Good afternoon and welcome everyone to the second Dean's Lecture of this year. I'm very excited today to welcome Michael Specter, who's a staff writer at The New Yorker. Not only is Michael a very engaging communicator, but he also addresses subjects that have become even more relevant with the political changes and debates that have occurred in our nation over the past year. Michael is the author of the book, Denialism, How Irrational Thinking Hinders Scientific Progress, Harms the Planet, and Threatens Our Lives. When Michael published this book in 2009, the public's trust in our institution, and in particular the institution of science, was already in decline. This skepticism has continued to intensify. In the middle of last year, Gallup released survey results showing that Americans' confidence in institutions had fallen to a historic low of 32%. Faith in television news and newspapers and Congress dropped 10 points between 2007 and 2014. Along with this loss of agreement about what constitutes fact or fiction comes a loss of unity. As last year's election results indicated, we're all in danger of becoming even more entrenched in our relative tribes. Recently, I had the privilege of attending a gathering of Stanford science and technology leaders with John Holdren, who was President Obama's senior advisor on science and technology for both of President Obama's terms. John told us that we bear some of the responsibility for this national divide that we see in our society today. He asked those of us who were participating in the meeting whether or not any of us had spoken at a Rotary Club or similar community organization about the value of scientific discovery and the meaning of credible research. He then challenged us to think about how to better communicate the impact of our research, a task that oftentimes proves challenging for scientists. He asked our group, are we doing everything we can to share what science has done for us and what it can do in the future? That's precisely why writers like Michael Specter are so important. Michael is incredible not only at explaining the complexity behind a discovery, but also in conveying the exciting possibilities that the discovery holds for the well-being and the future of humanity. Michael's renowned career in journalism demonstrates his relentless commitment to the facts, to remaining objective, to upholding the very best of the scientific community, and to holding all of us as scientists and policymakers and corporations and others, holding us accountable. Before he came to The New Yorker, Michael was a roving foreign correspondent for The New York Times based in Rome. And from 1995 to 1998, he served as the Times Moscow bureau chief. And from 1985 to 1991, he worked at The Washington Post, where he covered local news before becoming the Post's national science reporter and later the Post's New York bureau chief. Now, if you've run into Michael at Stanford over the past few months, you may have seen him over at BioX, where he's been a visiting scholar working on an upcoming book about gene editing. And you may have noticed firsthand that he has a unique gift for balancing diversity of thought and respectful discussion. We're very privileged and honored that he's bringing that talent to us this afternoon. Please join me now in welcoming Michael Specter.
I'm gonna request an unkind introduction next time because I can never quite live up to anything that glorious. But thank you very much. Thank you for having me. And I have been here for 8 months, longer than I planned, but not long enough. I'm sort of a member of this community and I'm a member of the fake news community. So I'm about as worthless as you can be in the eyes of some people who run our government. Nonetheless, I'll prattle on for a little while, and I will leave some time for questions. We're definitely in a kind of special moment, I think it's fair to say. When Ronald Reagan became president of the United States, I thought the sky had fallen. I was so upset, I couldn't imagine what would happen to the country. I would pay serious money to exhume his body right now and slip it into the Oval Office. Because, you know, he had his problems, but he was a human. And though he did have his problems, and he even had his problems with reality, he made these ludicrous assertions, which by today's standards are just absolutely adorable. My favorite one was that ketchup was a vegetable and ought to be considered as such for the purposes of school lunch nutrition planning. You know, back in the old days, that was considered outrageous. You know, now we have people saying the former president tapped their repulsive home, and that's considered fine. The only thing Donald Trump ever said in his campaign that was 100% true was, I could shoot someone on Fifth Avenue and my supporters wouldn't leave me. I think that's actually true. And we have moved a really long way in a short time. But I think if you go back to the Reagan, those days, and you look in this direction, it didn't just happen. It didn't just happen overnight. In fact, a few years ago, Stephen Colbert, unfortunately, we're in a world where the only people who can make insightful comments are comedians because truth hurts too much. One of his great insights was to coin the term truthiness. Truthiness was, you know, there's something real about the assertion. It has the ring of truth. It doesn't matter that much if it's actually true. This was amusing then. Boy, we didn't know. And in fact, I'm amazed now to be standing before you talking essentially about a book I wrote a decade ago that I wish I hadn't had to write a decade ago. I wish I could be here and have you people say, what are you doing here? This is ridiculous. We understand how science works. We understand the good and the bad. And we don't need someone to talk about denialism. But we really do. And we do more than when I wrote that book. So another great thing about Donald Trump, I'm in vogue. But the question I tried to ask in that book, and the one I think we need to answer is, what happens to a country or a society when denialism becomes a way of life? You know, when I wrote that book, I was animated by the growing number of people who, when confronted with a reality they didn't like, chose to embrace a more comfortable lie. And I wasn't the only person who wrote about it or thought about it, but we know generally what we're talking about when we talk about that, whether it stems from suspicions about vaccines, dread of genetically modified organisms, confusion about climate science. There was a lot of fear that was irrational, still is, unfortunately, but it was based in fear. I think denialism is almost always based in fear. And a decade ago, I don't think I took fear seriously enough. I take it much more seriously now. And I think it's part of our problem. And one hopes a little bit of our solution. I should also cut to the end and tell you, I'm not solving these problems in this speech. So I sometimes get criticized for not solving this problem. And I do have a few ideas. I also have a lot more sympathy than I used to for people who are dubious about the rules of organized medicine, worried about the health of their infant children, skeptical about the corporations that make so many of our seeds and food. Reason, patience, and education don't always work, but they go much further than self-satisfied condescension. And that's what many people have been guilty of in the medical profession and people like me. Like, how could you not vaccinate your kid? Well, you know, on balance, that's a legitimate question and you could be legitimately outraged. It doesn't help a scared mother who's got a little baby who's afraid to tell her she's an idiot. And that's mostly what we do. And it isn't solving the problem. And we need to reach out in a different way than we ever have before. And I'll talk a bit about this, but I really feel that we're at an inflection point just in terms of what we can do with science and how close we are to letting it all slip through our fingers. I mean, we are at an unbelievable moment. I mean, I walk around this campus, the things people are doing are incredible. But we are now led in this unimaginable age of scientific achievement by the most arrogant and thoughtless denialist who has ever entered public life in this country. And I'm not here to just trash him, though I certainly am happy to do that. You have to remember that denialism isn't just an idea, it kills people. It kills people, it's killed. Climate denialism has killed people already, it's gonna kill a lot more. Thabo Mbeki, the former head of South Africa, killed hundreds of thousands of his citizens when he decided that these evil Western pharmaceuticals and their antiretroviral medicines were like some sort of attack on the South African people and that he ought to instead give them beetroot or garlic. And he literally killed hundreds of thousands of people in a country where millions were already dying of HIV. So this is something that happens. And it can happen not just in an evil way. You can decide that data about screening for mammograms are confusing and really don't show that it makes sense for women under a certain age to get a mammogram. And that is what an expert group found a few years ago. The Secretary of HHS, who was an Obama Secretary of HHS, overruled that group because politically, she wasn't gonna accept the data. And I understand politics matter, but at a certain point when you're overruling the actual data and the experts, why have them? Why have these things? Why not just decide yourself? If magic is as good as reality, then let's just use magic and save money and time. And, you know, with regard to the current president, I never thought I would say this, but I don't know what he means when he uses words. Like, I mean, I'm not kidding. You just like, I don't know what value he puts on actual individual words. And yes, they have a tremendous impact. And I think we're only beginning to see the effect of that. It's not just caustic battles between left and right. It's not just him denouncing the judiciary or the media or any other group. It's not even these hellacious budget cuts that would, I think, be quite scary if they came to pass. It's, you know, for me, what happens to a society when we start not to care about facts? When facts go away as the centerpiece of what we do? And I think we are there now. We are talking about this, and when President Trump issued that ban that so far has been overruled by the evil judiciary, my first thought was, how many kids are gonna be born in those countries this year and named Osama as a result of their feeling about this country? Because believe me, it's gonna be a bunch of them. And if we just spent some goddamn money and sent people to those countries and let them know what we are capable of, that could change. George Bush had Guantanamo Bay. And after that, I thought, it'll take a generation to get people in other countries to believe we're a decent country again. And overnight, that changed with Obama because people saw we're not as simple as they thought we were. And we're definitely not simple because look what's followed. But I make this point because I think you can change things. It's not the case that this is out of our grasp. But I think we need to worry about it. And I also think we should have been worrying about it all the time since I wrote that book and probably long before. You know, George Bush was guilty of some really difficult issues and lies. He and his administration basically opposed HPV vaccines, which are, in fact, a cancer vaccine and an effective one. And the idea that you would have an administration basically opposed was an administration that said, facts don't matter, or facts are what we say they are. And their issue was simple. It was simple and scary, which was sex was bad. And anything that, especially premarital sex, maybe marital sex, I'd never ask them. Anything that encouraged sex was bad, particularly if it was with younger people. And if you had a vaccine that let people be free of a particular disease, how can that be good? That's got to be good. I mean, that was an administration that took a website off a web page off the CDC website that encouraged people to use condoms and replaced it with one that denigrated condoms. That actually happened in the Bush administration. So we didn't just invent these horrors. And you know, I've said this a lot, but it's no less true. At some point, we're going to have an AIDS vaccine. I have to believe that. And when we do, you better get ready for the biggest fight there will be ever about medicine in Washington, because conservatives in this country will stand up and say it is wrong to give children an AIDS vaccine, because it'll just encourage them to do things we don't want them to do. And if you think I'm kidding, I hope that we can have that come to pass, and then we'll see if I'm right or not, because I'd love to have a vaccine. But don't kid yourself. There will be many, many, many people who will say, we cannot do things that will encourage people to act in the ways that we've been acting biologically since we were we. And you know, this has got some antecedents. In the last election, Michelle Bachmann, and I thought she was a politician who was as low as it could go. Again, I overestimate whatever. She said the HPV vaccine causes autism, and she said that publicly. It doesn't. We know it doesn't. But there are people out there that don't trust the press, and they don't trust institutions. And when they hear someone saying that, they get petrified. And I don't blame them. I don't blame people who are afraid of what's going to happen to their kid, or who contemplate what they might do to prevent a really terrible affliction for which there isn't a cure and no real treatment. I mean, we have to understand that. But what we've moved into now is we have a president who believes that stuff. I mean, he's tweeted about it. Tweeting is like his version of the Declaration of Independence. I guess that's just what we have now. But he's often tweeted about the connection between autism and vaccines. This is scary stuff. He's going to appoint Robert Kennedy Jr. to run a vaccine commission. Robert Kennedy Jr. is one of the most, I wouldn't say knowledge free, I would say anti-knowledge public figures who has ever lived. And everything he's written about vaccines has been forced to be retracted, corrected, proven incredibly wrong, and not just mistakes. I make a lot of mistakes. These were purposeful, vicious attempts to discredit the CDC, commissions, institutions. And at one point, he actually accused the pediatricians of the United States of joining with pharmaceutical companies to wreak autism on children. And like, really? Like, our nation's pediatricians want kids to have autism? I mean, how sick is that? But he's written that, and he said it. And he said it in public many times. And so that's who may be in charge of a commission, which, by the way, we don't need, on vaccine safety, because we know what there is to know about that. And I'm not saying we shouldn't pursue avenues to make them more safe, avenues to make them better. I resent the fact that people like Tony Fauci, who run the National Institute for Allergy and Infectious Diseases, spends half his time running around the country explaining to people why vaccines are useful. I want him to be in his lab inventing better vaccines, vaccines that will work for diseases we don't have. I don't want the best scientific minds of our time having to say things we know are true. But they do, and they should, and so should most of you. And I will get to that because I think Dean Miner mentioned it. It's a very critical, critical problem that we have. But how did we get there? You know, at some point, I think science became to be seen as a political entity. It became to be a thing. Like the AFL-CIO is a thing. The teachers' union is a thing. We, I say we loosely in the world of science, we're another interest group. We're an interest group. And that is pretty scary. And it makes me think some ambivalent thoughts about this March on Washington, which I'll come back to. And you guys can attack me for it like everyone else has. But that's fine. This White House has taken all those doubts, all those lies, all those concerns, and elevated them in a way that I never thought possible. I mean, you know, eventually Donald Trump's ridiculous outrages, caustic insults, and childish Twitter rants will fade into history. But it's going to take years to gauge the impact of having a habitual liar as president. When words like science and progress become unmoored from their meanings, the effects can be, and I think are, incalculable. And don't kid yourself, that's happening. That's happening right now with the ferocity that we have, I would say, we haven't seen in hundreds of years. I mean, not since the Enlightenment have basic, I don't want to call them truths, because I don't see science as a truth or an inaccuracy, I see it as a process. It's a process. It's not a religion, it's a process. It's a thing that you use to achieve certain goals. And the scientific method lets you do that. And sometimes it works. And when it works, you use it. And you use it until you have something better. When I was a kid, because my mother loved me, she gave me antibiotics every time I looked cross-eyed. Because antibiotics were good. I probably have no microbiota as a result. But it wasn't, we didn't know then. We didn't, my mother didn't know that giving me margarine probably is killing me. Butter was better. These are just things that evolve as we evolve, our knowledge grows. And we're always, I think, always gonna be able to look back a generation or a half a generation and say, really? They did that? And, you know, there's that Woody Allen movie where some guy was smoking and someone complained and he said, come on, tobacco's good for you. How many studies do we have to prove that? And that probably won't come to pass. But I mean, the fact is, we don't know everything, and we kind of sometimes pretend we do. And I think that's one of the problems that we've encountered. But it wasn't like this. You know, 50 years ago, it wasn't like this. This is a new-ish phenomenon. You know, after Sputnik, Eisenhower, who was a Republican in 1959, created the post of presidential science advisor. And he appointed, as the first head of that commission, a Harvard chemist named George Kistiakowsky, I think I pronounced that properly. Jerome Wiesner, who was a Democrat and would go on to run MIT, was his deputy. So we had a Republican running it in a Democrat as his deputy, weird enough. And then the next year, John F. Kennedy became president, who was a Democrat. And do you know what he did to that commission? He made the chairman the vice chairman, and the vice chairman the chairman. And everyone else stayed, and they continued to advise on and produce the best science the world has ever known. Could you imagine that happening now? I mean, you know, I kind of feel like when new administrations come in, they would put to death the previous science advisor if they could. It's not just a question of getting rid of them instantly. There's no thought of learning from them. You know, science used to be, molecules aren't Republican or Democrat, as far as I know. Maybe I'm missing something. They're molecules. Viruses are viruses. They don't decide who to infect. They don't care. They're just trying to move from one cell to the other. And sometimes they'll go into gay people, and sometimes they won't. They really don't care. And yet, we've imbued these things with meaning. And that is a really, I think, really scary fact. You know, since I've been writing about science, and I've written about other things, But I feel that we're kind of on the verge of losing the Enlightenment. And I know that that may seem weird and maybe extreme, but I don't think it is. I mean, what dictated the course of progress in the 20th century was data, observation, change. That one World War II, you could argue it as at least so far prevented World War III. There's always going to be a debate about what should you do, how should you do it. There was a time when people thought, smart people thought, let's develop our biological weapons program because it's cheaper and better than nuclear weapons. And I think what won the day there was, we already have a way to eliminate the world. Maybe we don't need to spend a lot of money and energy on biological weapons. But these are debates and doubts and fears we're always going to have. And the result of these fears is something that I don't think we'd seen before. So I live, most of the time I live in upstate New York, and Lyme disease is a terrible problem there. And if you don't, have not been exposed to it, then you would maybe dismiss it. I grew up in Connecticut, and I always used to think of Lyme as, you know, it's this thing, you get a red bullseye, you take antibiotics, fine. Which is mostly true. Except that in lots of cases, you don't get a red bullseye, or you don't notice, and it gets bad. And so people don't know how to deal with it. New York State, and there are some people, some doctors who give patients long-term intravenous IV treatment for which there no data supports that as being valuable. And there are lots of incidences of people getting infections and dying as a result. So there are studies going on, legitimate studies about are there ways to treat Lyme with long-term IV antibiotics. But so far, there's never been a study that says you ought to do it. The New York State Senate passed a law a year and a half ago saying it would be against the law for an insurance company not to accept a claim for long-term IV use, and no doctor could be sued or otherwise mistreated or brought before a medical examiner for giving people long-term IV drug abuse. Now, yeah, doctors are oversued and our medical malpractice is a shame, but that would have been a good one. You know, the idea that a legislature is now basically telling physicians that you aren't allowed to use the best science, and we're not going to protect you any better than we protect these people that we know are not using the best science. I found it horrifying, scary, and it hasn't changed. It's still true, and some really intelligent people support it. And this is the type of thing I think happens when we kind of get divorced from what is real and what isn't, what can be proven, what can't be. And some of that is fear-based, because Lyme disease is really scary, and a lot of people where I live spend a lot of their time, you know, it isn't liver cancer and it's not malaria, but it's a significant problem. And I've seen again and again in the last 15 years of writing about science, issues where people just don't care, like flu shots. Nobody will get a flu shot. Now, flu shots aren't perfect. You know, we're kind of used to 99.78% effectiveness, and flu shots are usually 50, 60, sometimes worse, sometimes better. It's a guess. 50, 60 is better than zero. And in 2009, fewer than 30% of Americans got a flu shot when H1N1 came out. Now, H1N1 was thought to be a novel virus that would be extremely damaging. It turned out not to be, but it infected a third of the world. So if it had been a problem, 300 million people would have died like that. That's gonna happen. That's biology. We're not gonna be able to stop viruses. If anything, our life is one conducive to encouraging them to move around. I mean, I've been in the Cameroonian jungle and seen people eat dead gorillas and monkeys. And they do that because they need to eat. And there's nothing else. And because it's available. And they bring them to market because there's deforestation. And then the people bring those animals to other places. And they bring the viruses that we all know kill us.
And, you know, a 1,000 years ago, if HIV broke out in a village in Central Africa, it might have killed some people. Maybe it would have killed the whole village, but that would have been it. Because where else would it have gone? It wasn't getting on the 715 to Paris. And this is a different world. We are actually equipped to deal with this different world because, well, we have that problem. We now, for the first time ever, can look at the molecular construction of a virus, and we can say, gee, how can we rearrange this so that we can defend against it? That's a wonderful thing. But we're not using that capability yet, and we're not using it properly, and most of our flu vaccines are grown in eggs in Pennsylvania the same way they were in 1947. And that is because people don't focus on what doesn't present an immediate danger. As soon as, you know, a quarter of America dies of a virus, people will pay attention. But right now, what happens is flu comes through, old people die, sometimes young people die, most people just get incredibly sick, and life goes on. And it's as if you have to have some horrific thing happen. Paul Offit, who's a very talented infectious disease doctor and a vaccine person who helped develop the rotavirus vaccine, has said we need polio in the United States. He's a nice guy, and I don't think he really means to say it that way, but his point is if there was a polio outbreak, we'd pay attention. But we don't pay attention now because we don't, like, people get worked up about measles. I've asked this in different groups, and this is an unfair, statistically weird group to ask this of, but how many of you have ever seen measles? Okay, shut up. But this is Stanford Medical School. In general, you get about 3 people out of 500. And by the way, it wasn't even a quarter who raised their hand. If you've never seen measles, if your physician has never seen measles, it's hard to get all worked up about it, even though it killed about 130,000 people last year, just nobody who lives in Palo Alto. And I don't, you know, I just think that is one of our problems. One of our problems is that we're so good. We got the low-hanging fruit. And we expect science to work for us in ways, you know, science is an art. It's an art. We know a lot of things, but you have to use them in a sophisticated way. I hurt my knee when I was here, and I had to have an operation. And basically, somebody drilled some holes in my knee and sewed it back together. And Jason Dragoo, colleague of some of yours, did a fantastic job. But he also could have really done a bad job. It isn't cut and dried. It's an art. And even molecular biology is, in many ways, an art. And I think we pretend that this is the truth. I went to Brazil a couple years ago. There's a company called Oxitec. It's been bought by another company. But it was making genetically modified mosquitoes to try and stamp out the really bad dengue epidemic that was in Brazil. Dengue's, many of you know, because you've seen measles, a terrible disease. It's called breakbone fever is its nickname. It's extremely painful. It can cause many other subsequent illnesses, too. And in Brazil, these guys were basically editing mosquito eggs so that when they mated, the female would die, the eggs would not have wings, and therefore couldn't fly away, and they would all die. And it worked really well. It's been working really well. No chemicals. And by the way, these mosquitoes fly 100 meters in their lifetime if they're big travelers. And they live 10 days if they're centenarians. So it's not like this is an experiment of Jurassic Park-ish, you know, where the mosquito's going to go off and have sex with a cat, and then we're going to have dinosaurs. You laugh. You laugh. This is our life. But you know, those guys were very careful in Brazil. They went around and talked to people. And also, the Brazilians have a problem. So then, because of climate change and because of the fact that eggs of mosquitoes like to mate in the wells of used tires and the tire trade has been good, suddenly Key West had this problem for the first time in 30 years. So they had a very enlightened mosquito control guy who said to the Oxitec people, come give a presentation. The Oxitec people were six entomologists from Oxford. And they were like, I love them. They're nerdy entomologists. They care about bugs. They got up there and they started talking, and I don't know if you guys, the demographics of Key West is a little like here, you know? Everyone drives Lexuses and Teslas. They're all pretending, they think they're left wing and they care about the environment, but they're mostly solipsistic narcissists. And they got up one after the other to rip these people to shreds. They're like an evil corporation like Monsanto. They're trying to take over our environment. These guys didn't know what hit them. And by the way, nobody in Key West was saying, gee, we're just going to let these mosquitoes be. They were dumping DuPont chemicals in the backyard. And they do that now. And somehow that's better. That makes them feel more comfortable. These anti-GMO lunatics are more comfortable dropping chemicals in their backyard than trying to find a biological solution to a biological problem. And you know, we see this again and again. I'll just give you, I'm gonna talk for a little more, but I wanna get to some solutions. But I do just wanna tell you this one other anecdote. There's a woman named Ingrid Newkirk. She's the head of the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, and most doctors probably have her face on a dartboard. I wrote a profile of her a while ago, and I spent a lot of time with her. And she's a very complicated person. And she's done some good. On the science thing, not so much. But she's done a lot of good when it comes to the way animals are treated. And about 4 years ago, she issued a kind of challenge. She said, I'll pay $1 million to the first lab that can make chicken in the lab that tastes like real chicken. I think everyone in this room knows $1 million is like how much the coffee bill is. But it was the point that counts. And there are a lot of people working on that problem now, and both with fake meat and with substitutes for meat. And the response of the people at PETA was amazing, which was outrage. They were outraged. They couldn't believe, if they would fire Ingrid if she wasn't a dictatorial ruler who has no, you know, buddy who can challenge her, they hated this idea. They hated the idea that you should eat something you like, even if it didn't kill animals, which is the point of PETA. The point of PETA is not to use animals for our research, eating, pleasure, none of that. I've seen her, I saw Ingrid take a seeing eye dog away from someone. I mean, they're crazy. But the idea that these people would say, no, we can't, I mean, what would happen if people started to have that taste for meat again? This is how sick people have gotten. This is how divorced they are from reality, that they would object to something put forth by their legitimately lunatic leader about just trying to shift us, our priorities away from killing animals. Expectations is a problem, but I think the bigger problem is that we don't care. And by we, I mean the press to some degree, large degree, whatever, and scientists. I've had tremendous trouble with scientists because while they're really nice to me, they really don't give a shit about actual people. They want to work in their labs. I had this incident at the Broad where I spent a bunch of time before I was here where I wanted to see some research that a very famous person was doing. And he was like, I'm not showing you that. And I said, well, I will not print what you don't want me to print. I've been doing this a long time. I haven't screwed anyone yet. He said, that's not it. I get money from DARPA. And I'm like, dude, that's my money. This is my money. That's not DARPA. DARPA's my money. But this guy feels government funds. He doesn't have to share. He's a brilliant guy. He's going to go out of business. You're all going to go out of business if you have this attitude. All of you. And I cannot stress this enough. I'm not kidding. Right now, we're at a point where the population, particularly the solipsistic West Coast population, thinks GMOs will harm them no matter how much evidence there is to the contrary. But we're not yet at the point where people are flipping out about CRISPR or gene drive yet. Gene drive is a mechanism that would change the genetics of an entire species, and it's scary. And it could do some real harm, but it could also do real good. It could actually get rid of malaria. We need to discuss that. We need to have those debates. We need to decide, are things better or worse? There's a numerator and a denominator to every number, and people only talk about the risk. So yeah, is the risk 1 in 4? Because if it is, that's kind of bad. If it's 1 in 400 million, less bad. And nobody ever makes those distinctions. And we need to start doing that, and you need to start doing that. Because you have a great story to tell, and you're not telling it. Many of you, the younger generation, I think, understands this, but you're really busy. And the demands of your job are be in the lab, produce things, get printed and sell in Nature and, you know, those other ridiculous publications that you live by, and so do I. And you're forgetting, you're taking your eye off the ball. The ball is the people. You know, so now I will tell you what I think about this march on science, and hopefully you won't throw organic tomatoes. I don't think it's a good idea. I don't think I'm going to go. I haven't decided. I am ambivalent. But what is it we're trying to say? That we want science funding? That we think it's wrong to minimize this research? Yeah, totally. Is that going to do that? Or is it going to just give people, you know, there are a lot of conservatives in Congress who think science funding is a good idea. Are we going to polarize ourselves so that we really are a union? And when people, and before you ask me, what about the Women's March? Women are a gender. It's science is an idea. I do think it's a different situation. But I really worry. I would love every person who's going to Washington to go to a county, go to Tennessee, go across the bridge here where these lunatics think GMOs are going to come kill them, and just sit down and have coffee with people and talk to them. You can actually convince people. I've taught a course for a few years at Bard College, which is near me, on the global future of food. And everyone, they're all very liberal kids, and they all think GMOs are going to kill them. And it's really easy to tell them that your problem is not with GMOs. You don't like big corporations. And if you don't like big corporations controlling seeds, fine. Let's deal with that. There are avenues, political, social. There are lots of ways you can deal with that. It's not a molecular thing, and you need to make a distinction. And they get that. They, by and large, get that. And I don't think we make that case. And I will tell you that if you don't start making that case about the work you're doing in these labs on genetics, you know, you're not going to be able to do what you want to do. Drew Endy, who teaches in bioengineering, is a friend of mine. He had a couple postdocs last year trying to figure out how to make a dragon, which actually is not that hard. You repurpose the sac of a lizard, the poison sac. You make methane from yeast. You put some flint in the teeth. You're there. The point is, I make fun of Drew because he's one of the most articulate explainers of science in America, and he's relentless in his attempt to do it. And actually, on Saturday, he and I went to an opening in Oakland, not of an art gallery, but of a new office for a place called The Odin. The Odin is a do-it-yourself biohacking place run by a very brilliant and kind of weird biophysicist. And he'll send you CRISPR kits and PCRs and all sorts of stuff, and you can make this stuff yourself. And I know a lot of people are afraid of that. But I don't think our problem is going to be solved until we're not afraid of that. And I would like to see every third grader in the United States do gene editing on worms in their class. Put a phosphorescent gene in. Change the color. It can be done. It can be done cheaply. If that happens, kids are going to come home and say, Mom, I turned a green worm blue. And they're going to understand just the visceral delight of doing that. And most people, particularly people my age, they do not have that sense. They don't get it. The word gene scares them unless it's like denim. And I hate to call anybody a lost cause, but I think my group of Americans kind of are. But we're dying out, don't worry. The younger people can be different, and you have to care. It's really, so this whole why is science, why are people not believing us, why do facts not matter? You don't make your case. I mean, there's a lot of other reasons, and I've gone through some of them, but you don't, that's, what is more important? Solving a problem in a lab that's really cool, or getting people to understand it? And just so I'm clear, I'm not saying every person in every lab needs to go out and be a public persona. Some people don't do that. That's not their thing. I don't even think every principal investigator needs to do it. But if there's a project, and there's not one person associated with that project who can tell its story in a somewhat coherent, maybe even compelling way, project's going to go away. And again, let me be clear, I'm not saying, like, how do we get from here to curing cancer? I'm talking about the delight of doing this. CRISPR, one of the greatest things to me about CRISPR is it was just found by some Japanese biologist looking in E. coli in 1987 for something else, and they saw this weird cluster of nucleotides, and they wrote in their paper, literally, and we saw this weird cluster of nucleotides, and we don't know what it is. And that was it for 8 years, and then some people started unraveling it. That's how science works. It's really cool. I don't know anything more exciting than that. But if you don't tell that story, it doesn't matter what else you do. So I want you to ask questions, but I just want to end on a slightly less horrifying note. Some of you are old enough or aware of medicine enough to know who Everett Koop was. He was the Surgeon General of the United States, and he was the most right-wing, anti-abortion lunatic who ever lived. Henry Waxman, a brilliant congressman who ran the Subcommittee on Health and Environment, spent a year trying to keep him from being Surgeon General. Who wastes their time even trying to keep someone from being Surgeon General? But he was so corrosive that there was, finally, Henry stopped. He figured, what can a Surgeon General do? This was the Reagan administration, and they were so happy because he was so right-wing, they went right out and said, do a report on AIDS. So we went out, and he did a report, and he spent a year, and he came back and said, by the time they're in fourth grade, every American should know what a rubber is and how to put one on. Again, this is like one of the most conservative men I've ever known. Okay, so Reagan went crazy, everyone hated him, and then they said, well, you're the most well-known anti-abortion activist in America, do a report on abortion. So finally, a home run. He disappeared for like a year, and one of his people called me and said, I was at the Washington Post then, Koop isn't gonna issue an abortion report. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's just interviewed hundreds of people. He said, yeah, but you better come talk to him. I said, I'm coming. And Koop basically said to the American people, to me and anyone else who would listen, there's not enough data to say you shouldn't have an abortion or you should have an abortion. Some people will be better off, and the world would probably be better off if those people had an abortion. For others, that's not the case. I personally, Everett Koop, believe morally it's wrong to have an abortion, but as a society, I have to say this. And it was unbelievable. When he left his job, Henry Waxman, who detested him, was very close to him. And he wrote a memoir, and he signed his book to Henry, to the biggest man in Congress. Henry's like 5'1". And I bring that up because I then saw him, he was 96 right before he died, and he said, I never changed my stripes. I still believe what I believe, including homosexual behavior is evil. I mean, he is really a lunatic, but he also said, but data's data, and I believe in that. And this guy believed in facts as much as he believed in God, and he believed in God a lot. So I don't think it's impossible, and he is someone who I revere for that very purpose. He and I never agreed on anything politically, but he didn't care. He just took the facts where they ought to go. And that is something that can happen, but we have to make it happen, and I don't think we're really trying very hard. So that, on that slightly cheerful note, I'll entertain questions if there are any. Thanks. Are we question free? No, didn't think I had that much luck. Go ahead.
That was really interesting. I think I liked your point about inspiring the sort of delight in science, but I wonder, how do we get from there to people actually believing in facts? It seems like a bit of a path from there.
So I think we have to break this down, and it's not so much about believing in facts, not believing in facts. People believe in what, like, most people are going to believe what their mother tells them, not what some guy in a white lab coat that they never saw tells them. So if we were in someone's kitchen talking about this stuff, they might see the scientists in that kitchen as responsible human people with families of their own, and they just wouldn't be this distant thing. And I think, unfortunately, that's what we have to do. We have to make people literate. It's not easy. It's not going to happen tomorrow afternoon. It's a process. But I think that process can work. I think it has always worked in the past, and we haven't done it. And that's why, you know, march on Washington if you want, but I'd rather have you march on Tennessee, Mississippi, and Marin County.
Thank you. Hi. Hey, thanks for a really cool, engaging talk. I'm a grad student here, and I really like the points you made about Palo Alto being a weird place to live right now. It seems fake and disconnected. I personally, as a brown person, as a woman, as someone who's undocumented and is scared all the time, I'm having a hard time living here, even being on this campus. There are a lot of people here who are doing great work and being in their labs, but nobody cares about people like me or my story. Even the administration is having a hard time, I think, being brave at this time. So I want to know, how do I engage my classmates? How do I engage my professors? How do I engage deans and ask them to care about stuff like this and not make it a thing, not make it political, and not make this administration normal?
Really, you think I can answer that?
So could you just solve that? That would be great.
I've talked to the dean of this institution who introduced me so nicely. Stanford, I know Stanford was standing by to pay the legal bills, no matter what they were, for anyone who was getting kicked out, who couldn't get in. I mean, I understand what you're saying. I'm not you, obviously. I think there are lots of people around here who understand and see the point of doing something. I don't think that was, I mean, Silicon Valley is a place obsessed with itself and its laptops. That's true. But I think some of the people there are starting to understand that this might challenge their laptop ownership. You know, and even their Tesla, their $7,500 credit for getting a Tesla's going to go away. I'm kidding a little, but I think people are waking up to the situation. I can't say I don't think it's as bad as you say it is, because how would I know? But I do think there are people and groups around here who care about you and what you stand for and would try to protect you. So I guess find them.
Everybody raise your hands. No. Okay, thanks so much.
Okay.
Hi, this is sort of a follow-up question to the first question. I think that some people have been affected by a long history of sort of past abuses by maybe the establishment, the medical establishment, or corporations. You mentioned Monsanto. There's a lot of controversy around that. So what can we do to combat the fear of experts, the fear of
go to people's kitchens. Eat scrambled eggs with them. I mean, I'm serious. Experts are these people who hover above us, wear white coats, no offense, white coats are good, and we don't know them. The way you make experts real is go talk to people. You know, this is what I do for a living. And a lot of these people at this campus and other places I've hung out, they're super engaging. The excitement they have about their field comes like right out of them the second you meet them. And other people would feel that too. I don't have special antenna. You get that. So I would say, open yourselves up. Go talk. I think what Dean Miner said, how many of these people ever do go to a VFW or a Rotary Club meeting? They don't. So gee, I wonder why 65 million people voted for Donald Trump. I mean, really, these things are not unconnected.
And outside the elite media outlets that people typically go to?
There's nothing wrong with elite media outlets. Listen. By the way, I just have to say, Donald Trump's been the best thing that ever happened to the New Yorker. Our subscriptions have, I think in the last 3 months,
are equal to what they were in the previous 2 years. The same for the New York Times and the Washington Post. I'd gladly give the money back. I think we all would. But what I do think that means is that some people who took it for granted until recently are willing to spend a little money to try and find out what seems to be true. Again, it's not an easy thing, but talk to people. I don't think there's anything inherently, I don't think there's a I hate experts gene. I think there's a you think you know everything gene, and I'm beneath you. And that's a problem, but that can be solved. I told you, the solution to this is very, it's like a cultural revolution without killing 60 million people, but it needs to happen.
So the one advantage of the March for Science is that it gives the world a chance to see that scientists look like real people.
Does it?
Well,
really, is that what they're going to see?
I don't think people know at all what scientists look like.
I think the world will see a bunch of leftist Hillary people who hate Donald Trump, and it's an occasion for making that case. And if I go, I'll see a lot of people I know, and we'll have beers in Georgetown.
So I think as a group, we need to, separate from the march, I think the more that we give the populace a vision of what scientists look like, that we shop at Safeway or wherever, where we're normal people.
I agree with that. I mean, I'm not anti the march. I'm ambivalent about the march. I really don't know what I think about it, which is an odd thing in my brain.
But Michael, I so appreciate your writing, and I want to thank you because I've really enjoyed following you in The New Yorker.
Thank you.
The problem is, how do we get your pieces into Breitbart News? I mean, in California, we have a real
surely
problem.
There's a neurosurgeon here who can help me.
We have it. We have, you know, California. We're how many millions of votes in way over for Hillary. We don't have as many opportunities to talk to Trump supporters to explain science.
I understand.
So
how
can we deal with that?
Well, first of all, you all have families. Mm-hmm. Some of them live outside of California. You know, California is a special place in good and crazy ways. So it is a little different. But okay, apparently the words last question have been bandied about. I will just say this about the specialness of California. California is home to the biggest anti-vaccine movement and the most lunatic fringe anti-GMO people on the face of the earth. And they also happen to be highly educated, and some of you are probably in this room. And the point is, it's not a demographic left or right, up or down. It's everywhere. Just if you want to just convince people in California that go to Newport, tell them to vaccinate their kids. You don't have to even leave California. Okay, last question. She was in line first, so I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I just hope it lives up to everyone's expectations for the last question. So on the other side of the question about, you know, how to engage people on the sort of like other side of the spectrum or people who are, you know, anti-vaccinators or like anti-GMO, how do we depoliticize science in the political realm? And so like you said about, you know, like the person, Coop, like who, you know, was very conservative but had to come out and say, yes, like abortion is fine, or, you know, like, yes, we should, you know, like vaccinate our
children. He didn't say it was fine, he hated it, but he said that it ought to be the right of someone to decide for themselves, and that is not your basic conservative stance these days. How do we do that? I mean, I'm like a broken record. Talk to people. I don't think marching on Washington is gonna depoliticize science. And it is also probably true that not marching on Washington is gonna, it's not like people are gonna wake up and say, oh, those guys are so reserved. They're kind of not political. So I think depoliticizing science means focusing on the things that are real. And as long, you know, everyone's crazy about climate change, and they should be. Not one person in all of this planet ever in all of history has been made demonstrably ill from eating a product made with genetically modified organisms. There's never been a suit. There's never been a hospital case. We live in the most litigious society in the world. Surely someone would have sued if they could. And yet, 40% of Americans are opposed to it. 47% of Americans think angels are real and evolution is made up. I mean,
this isn't, I don't think political issues are our biggest problem. You're not satisfied.
I guess, no, I appreciate it. That is sort of similar to what you've been saying. I guess I meant more like in terms of like politicians who, like, yes, are real people, but are not.
How many people in this room have ever written to, called, or visited their representative in Congress? Oh, for God's sakes. Okay. Congratulations. You're all good human beings. But very rarely do people do that. And I would say do that. I mean, you know, one of the things I have some hope on the healthcare bill is Republicans in Congress, they're starting to wake up in the morning and think, I think I might have to get reelected again. And I don't care if they're good guys as long as they know they have to get reelected and the people that they're screwing over are going to vote for the other guy. And I think that's sort of inching into reality now. So talk, I mean, I don't have a better answer than talk. We don't talk. We don't. There's a guy named J.D. Vance who wrote a book. Yes, fantastic book, Hillbilly Elegy. He grew up as a right-wing guy, went to Yale Law School, was a Marine, went to Yale Law School. I don't want to waste all your time, but he explains this disconnect better than anyone I've ever seen. And he does it in a non-political, rational way. And I think everyone should read that book. I mean, everyone in this room. But you all call your congressman, you know what measles is. I don't want to talk to groups like you anymore. Anyway, thank you very much for coming.
The preceding program is copyrighted by the Board of Trustees of the Leland Stanford Junior University. Please visit us at med.stanford.edu.